Thank you very much, Lynn. Let me go through the minimum protocol that needed in this kind of occasion. And to thank everybody here, the diplomatic corps. I recognize the representative of the foreign affairs of Singapore, our sister from Nigeria, from South Africa, ambassador from South Africa, and also people from Nigeria. My wife is half Nigeria almost, so that gives me the right to cite them at the end. But before that, I think I should thank the NTU for the opportunity, and the ambassador, and my brother Shabir. He did what Churchill will say, you know, before the facts comes a dream. There was a dream a couple of years ago to have this center. It's now a reality. It's a challenge in a country, I think, where we still need to work a lot to know each other. So to be a pioneer in Singapore is not an easy process. And I think you did it institutionally. Many people have done promotion, but you set it up in stone. And we have this institution today. So I'm very honored to be the first distinguished fellow. But also all my colleagues, John, the director of the center, Folake, and others who are working tirelessly to make this institution the hub of knowledge in Singapore, as far as Africa is concerned. It's tough to come after another African from the diaspora and from Standard Chartered to talk about Africa. And this will give me also the opportunity probably to skip a couple of things because you have summed up very well the key issue. But I think on what I will talk about doing business, and people keep asking, you know, why is it important to do business? Why is it important the element of doing business in Africa? And I think it might look like a simple question, but for many years, African leadership was struggling about it. The issue of doing business wasn't the kind of the first variable when they were drafting policy change. It was about development, but the doing business wasn't at the center stage. But many things have changed. Obviously, the world is a very fast-changing one. But I think at some point we realize that there was some urgency. And one of the major urgency in the context was the issue of youth employment. Because people realize, you know, how are we going to give job to all this massive wave of young people with lot of hormones and energy who are coming? Well, the majority of those are nonsense, not nonsense people. If you look at statistics, we'll be probably in the region of 10 to 12 million people looking for a job almost every year. McKinsey said that in the next 10 to 15 years, we'll be in a region of 70 new jobs created in Africa. Obviously, if the economy, if the growth worldwide continue to be like 2 years ago, but we see that we are going to a very turbulent time. So I don't think that that 70 million that McKinsey was talking about 2 years ago of new job will happen easily. Something also on the context was the reduction in foreign aid and what I call the resetting of the aid and trade narrative. I'm a former World Bank guy, you know? So our job was, how do we cook the report in a way that the aid issues is something very important? And for many years, it gave the country's impression that the most important was to make sure that the Minister of Finance and his team worked tirelessly to attract foreign aid. Not foreign investment, foreign aid. And that created a mindset of laziness in many of our administration, in many of us. But at some point, things started changing. We realized that trade was really the way out. And there are many factors that help create that new mindset. One that I like to point out is the case of Germany. And I think many of them are already, I think Didier has heard this argument from me on many occasions, but it's important to give it to you now. If you remember the process of unification of Germany after the fall of the Berlin Wall, it was important to reunite the two Germany and to integrate the two countries. And then the West Germans start spending a lot of money. And when I tell people the numbers, when we did some of the work actually inside the World Bank at that time, you ask someone, well, how much do you think West Germany spent on a yearly basis to upgrade East Germany and to reunite the two Germany? Well, someone said, oh, 10 billion, 20 billion. No. The numbers were in the region of $150 billion a year, over 10 years, predictable $150 billion to East Germany to upgrade infrastructure, to upchange the mindset, to educate, to train. But yet, at the end of the process, after 10 years, there was a lot of discussion when people were asking, was this money really had an impact on the unification? And that was an important element because at that time also, there was a lot of discussion about how much money we need to fuel into Africa. You remember all the Bono, all this star system, people going around raising money for Africa, songs were very useful. But I was telling people how much you guys are trying to raise with all this charity style concert and others. And I said, no, in the next 10 years, the vision is to have at least $50 billion for Africa. I said, you know how much the Germans have spent for their own unification, for a small corner of Europe? And what was the result? Do you think that if the Germans spend $150 billion in a predictable way every year, you think that $50 billion will do the trick to develop an entire continent? So there was a lot of new debate. And I think Africans realized that the way out was certainly to go toward trade and to attract foreign direct investment. I'm not saying that it's a total consensus now, but the new narrative has helped for Africans to realize that they are on their own, and as the ambassador was saying, they need to put the house in order. There are other issues, also, obviously, democracy and other aspects. I wanted also to show this Africa attractiveness and just to confirm what my brother from South Africa was saying here in terms of the attractiveness of Africa, and it has increased. I don't have the number for 2015, but it has increased. And it's still an attractive country, continent. People still believe about the importance of investing, but the risk perception is still big. And I think a lot needs to be done on that side. So now the question is about the mega trend. Again, this mega trend is also opportunities that I think business people in this part of the world can piggyback on it and take it as an opportunity on what can be done in business. Many look like challenge, but there are more opportunity than challenge for the way I see the way we present it. Demography, I think a lot has been said. I think all those numbers that were presented earlier was basically explaining the importance of demography and how it could be a key driver. But we have to be careful. I mean, if you look at a country like Niger, 6 kids per woman, that's the average. That's a good thing to have many babies. It helps in terms of consumer, but you need to also follow through with the infrastructure. The challenge to have services. I mean, 6 children per woman in Niger, it's a lot. It's also an opportunity, no doubt, in terms of consumer. I mean, we talk about it. Someone used to say that if you are in the business of making diapers, you should be in Nigeria because in the next 3 to 5 years, the number of kids that will be born in Nigeria will be equivalent of the entire Western Europe in 1 year. So if you're in the business of making diapers, you know where you should be. We are making a lot of babies. And it's an opportunity, I mean, a huge one. I mean, you're saying you're looking about the Africa consumer spending in 2020. Some say that it could be even more than that if the intra trade also trickle up. You might have numbers even more optimistic than that. There's opportunity in food, I mean, a need for food security. We talked about exporting food, but we need for ourselves. We need to eat. And that alone is also a key driver. But we have challenges. I mean, the post-harvest food loss, I mean, one third. If you look at West Africa, one of the biggest producers of mango, but the quantity of mango that's destroyed because there's no supply logistic that enable to take the product from the farm to the urban center. And by the way, when I was talking about the number, Africa in 2015 will be more than 50% of the population will be in the urban area. So those people need to eat also in the urban area. The farmer productivity challenge, you have mentioned it. Certainly the use of fertilizer and better mechanization of the agriculture, the issue of land, because we have small plot of land, it's difficult to do really be productive on those small plots. You need much bigger extension, but it's also the challenge of the land distribution and how do you fix it in many of our countries, and that requires a lot of leadership. And also how much we need to increase. I mean, you give the number of 70%, so even more than what I was thinking on 60% to satisfy the expected demand of food globally. And this is not because we are also growing ourselves, but when I look at the numbers, 1 billion people every 11 years in the world. Is it sustainable? How do you feed this set of people? I mean, there are a lot of things in technology is going to happen in terms of using a small plot of land and being more productive. But in terms of food, you're right about the land. I think there will be progress and people will make some agricultural product without using a lot of land. But there will be a lot of artificial things there. And if you need real food, it will have to happen in Africa, in the real land that God has given us. The second trend is capital. And I mentioned here the issue of African saving. This is a quick snapshot of the banks in Africa. The number is not enormous. I mean, $665 billion asset, but it shows also the room for progress in some of these banks. And all these banks haven't been really, I would say, very proactive for many reasons in terms of funding the economy. Many will say that as a commercial bank, they couldn't take long-term risk, and the judicial system in many of our countries is not strong enough for them to be able to be more aggressive in funding the SME sector. But we have banks who are growing. Myself was involved in the expansion of the Ecobank group for many years. We moved in 2007 for a bank who had an asset base of less than $1 billion to now a $30 billion bank with the largest coverage across Africa. Now they've tied up a little bit with South Africans and PIC, but there are other countries that are trying to take over some of the banks. I mean, you have Qatar, who are now looking for the banking sector in Africa. So some people are concerned in what extent we are losing our banks, but I think still a lot of opportunity on that. But I'm saying that the need for saving, because at the end of the day, to go back to what the ambassador was saying, we need to put our house in order, but we need also to make sure that we get the saving from our own economy. It's good to have the foreign direct investment, it's good to have foreign aid, but what we are doing with our own money? And if you look at the numbers, more than $500 billion, as some of my friends say that is more than that, the global reserve. And you know what? One third of our global reserve is invested outside Africa. So you ask yourself, if you don't believe, I mean, if you don't trust your own economy, why do you want someone else to trust it? So we have all our money outside the continent, our reserve. And yet, we are talking about $90 billion that we need in term yearly for infrastructure, to finance infrastructure. So a lot needs to be done. I know that it will require some innovation on the way we use the money from our reserve, but this is definitely an issue that sometimes sounds taboo in many of our countries, but we need a very serious discussion about how to use our foreign reserve to develop our own economy. That's very important, because before we start knocking other people's doors for more money. The remittances, I mean, you are apart from the diaspora, others apart from the diaspora, a lot of money, but many of the money from the diaspora goes for consumption, and there's a need here for opportunities, and probably the fintechs and other to start looking at where to use the money from our diaspora. The Israelis are very good on this, the way they have used the money from the diaspora on bonds, and they have managed to channel resources for their own economy. We're not doing it. A lot of money in 2016, we're talking about 40 billion, some people are talking about even more. But with the economic crisis, I think this number can go a little bit softer, but a lot of money yet coming to that. And also the way we could reduce, I mean, the charges to the money transfer. It costs a lot for people in the diaspora to send money to Africa. And that's something that we need to deal with, and technology will help. Foreign direct investment, I mean, you will see that it comes after the reserve and after the remittances, because it doesn't mean that I don't believe in foreign direct investment. I think it's very important. But I think, again, there's a lot we could do first or in a parallel track with the money coming from abroad. And that there's some surprise. I mean, our own works show that in Southeast Asia, the stock in terms of investment is in the region of 80 billion. Nobody talk about it between Malaysia, Singapore, and other people in other countries. So these companies, I mean, many are not GLC from Singapore. People say that at some point some of GLC will be even more aggressive to come to some of the market, but you are seeing in energy and other sector. Even Thailand, for example, is this year, even with the price of oil, are very aggressive in oil and gas in Africa. So a lot of big prospects. Well, the Chindia factor, you know, China and India, I mean, you mentioned it earlier, and I think it will slow down a little bit, I think. The third trend is regional integration. I'm very passionate about this. Very passionate because for me, it seemed to be a trend that if we don't address it properly in Africa, it will be difficult to have that transformation we need, and it will be difficult for investors to really have scale. Let's be frank, I come from a country of 1.5 million people, the size of Holland. Am I attractive for an investor? Not really. Now, we know what has happened and what has created the problem in the way Africa was divided into small pieces, and ethnic groups were also divided from a country to another. And I think after the independence, it was a wise decision from the leadership to say, we should not change the border from the colonial period. We should keep it. Although it was kind of tense, because many countries were saying, no, at the end of the day, before the colonial system, this portion of land was mine as a country, as a nation. But I think it was a wise decision for the leadership to say, we don't touch the borders that we have inherited from the colonial period. That was a very wise decision. Now, if you don't touch it, you need to do something through regional integration. Because there's an aberration here, but you to see the number of countries who are landlocked. It's almost impossible for many of these countries to really develop a dynamic trade with that level of, the way the geography have punished them. From Central African Republic to others. And so, for them to be able to take advantage of the trade, they need to be linked with other parts of the countries, with other countries, and have access to ports. I will mention it later on why I believe that it's important to have some corridors. But that's geography. We have 16 landlocked countries, the biggest. No continent has such a big number of landlocked countries. And that regional integration is the only way that I think you could erase those borders, the artificial borders, for Africans to be able to trade among themselves. If you look at the statistic, we're talking about 13% intra-African trade, much lower than the 40-something percent for Asia and for other continents like Latin America. And for that, you will need very courageous policy in terms of regional integration. Hopefully, East Africa is doing well. West Africa was ahead a couple of years ago. I think during the time of, actually it was funny, the dictatorship in Nigeria, in West Africa, the regional integration in West Africa was very dynamic. It has changed. Huge problem of leadership. But East Africa, if you see how Kenya, Rwanda, Uganda are getting together to strategic position in terms of railway, port, I think I see clearly that the big driver of growth will be the regional trade, the intra-regional trade. So the issue also of the regional integration is that if you don't combine many of the services, the road, the infrastructure, it will handicap your growth in terms of inefficiency that this geographical situation creates to African countries. It goes back to the issue of regional trade. I think I was giving the number. If you look at Mercosur, it's 17%. The European Union, obviously, 61, 67 for APEC, and then 12% on Africa. And there's here room for a lot of growth for many of the country if we manage to put in place the measure, the infrastructure to increase the regional trade. The fourth trend is technology. Obviously, these three elements that I give as an example here, the use of mobile phone, the connectivity, and some of the pioneering investment and initiatives like M-Pesa, but how Kenya has been completely ahead of many African countries and many countries in the world in terms of regulation. To be frank also, we have to recognize how the central bank was enormously proactive in engaging with some of these players to ease the regulation so you could develop the mobile payment. It was the central bank governor of Kenya that was that couple of years ago had the courage to be a first mover on this mobile banking business. So it's shaping business, but it goes beyond just the classical mobile payment. There's a lot that's happening in agriculture. If you see in dairy industry in Senegal, in Uganda, in the cashew business in Cote d'Ivoire, how technology has is helping actually the farmer to get more transparency, less corruption in dealing with the administration, thanks to the technology. Obviously, a lot of investment need to be done in terms of the infrastructure. I mean, the connectivity is not perfect. I mentioned it. If you look at how a country such as Rwanda has decided to put a fiber optic into the entire country, it brought a lot of change in terms of the way people use technology to commerce. And so these four trends for me, again, as I was saying initially, is where I think business could piggyback to identify opportunities for growth themselves. So it's look like challenges, but in the terrain of opportunity. And when you deal with Africa and taking this trend, I think you are not going with Africa in terms of just partying, it's a journey. The way you engage with Africa is not as a party, it's more as a journey. As a party, you get drunk and then it's finished. As a journey, you could go through the bumpy period because it's going to be a bumpy period. If you look at what's going to happen in 2015 and 2016, I guess it's going to be quite bumpy for the lack of liquidity, the problem of exchange rate, and the slowdown in India and China. So in terms of opportunities, I mean, many of this country, our brother from Standard Bank has mentioned a couple of countries that I think the growth will, the momentum for growth would be there. But I think I will say there's something missing in terms of, but, sorry again. Okay, there was one thing missing. But I will say the way you should approach most of this country, apart from the opportunity for investment, I think a corridor approach should be the best way. And on that one, I will see here two countries that I think in terms of doing business in the next couple of years would be important in having a corridor approach is Nigeria and Ethiopia. there will be a set of investment, I think, that will enable not only in intra-trade through these countries, because these two countries will be manufacturing countries. If you see the trend now in Ethiopia in terms of what they're doing in shoes business and other industry, the same could happen in Nigeria in a few years if the issue of energy is dealt with. And then these two countries can become manufacturing hub in Africa. And if they become manufacturing hub, there is an entire set of investment in corridor, the corridor coming from Lagos going up to Chad and certainly touching also Cameroon in terms of infrastructure, the logistics that need to be put in place, but also in Ethiopia, not only using the port like Djibouti, but also with the partnership they're having now with Kenya and others. So I will conclude here, and I think the Q&A will enable us to go more in detail with other indicators that we have also in the appendix that can provide or share some light on the opportunities and the challenge also that I see in the next 10 years in terms of doing business in Africa. Thank you very much.